In our last three episodes, I've spoken about the dark mysteries of astronomy. But astronomy isn't the only field of science with puzzling and unanswered questions. In fact, physics has presented the world's researchers with a couple of doozies. That sounds like a great new path of fascinating things to talk about in Subatomic Stories. Of all of the amazing scientific minds in the pantheon of modern physics, Einstein stands out as what the ancient Romans would have called primus inter pares, first among equals. His ideas are probably the most influential over the last century and a half or so. Two of the things Einstein is known for is his equation E equals MC squared and the theory of the Big Bang, which is tightly coupled to his theory of general relativity. Much has been said about just how right these two ideas are, including by me in many episodes of the series. However, there's a deep and dark secret about the two of them. When you combine them and then compare the resultant prediction to measurement, it's totally and completely wrong. It's really quite embarrassing when you get down to it. Let me explain. So first is the equation E equals MC squared. To start out, it's an equation with a right side and a left side connected by an equal sign. The C squared is just a constant number, so ignoring that, the equation says that energy equals mass and vice versa. People routinely say that this means that energy can be converted into matter and back again, and that's true to a degree, but only partly so. Actually, when you convert energy, you convert it into equal amounts of matter and antimatter. Convert a photon, and you make an electron an antimatter electron, or quark an antiquark. That's how it works, and it's true for all kinds of energy. It's also true that the two are always equal. The matter and antimatter are in identical amounts. That's an experimental fact that scientists have confirmed again and again. Equal. Remember that. So that's the first thing. The second thing involves the Big Bang. The universe was once much smaller and hotter, and it was full of energy. As the universe expanded and cooled, that energy transformed into the matter we see around us today. And that's a good thing. If that didn't happen, we wouldn't be here. But now we get back to that equal thing. According to all observations in all of our accelerator experiments, energy should have made matter and antimatter in exactly the same quantities. Our universe should consist of equal amounts of matter and antimatter, and yet, when we look around us at the stars and galaxies that make up the cosmos, we see only matter. So where is the antimatter? Well, of course, the short answer is that we don't know. That's the mystery. But here's what we do know. Now, some of you might ask how we know that there is no antimatter in the universe. After all, antimatter emits the same kind of light as ordinary matter. Maybe there are matter and antimatter galaxies, and that's a reasonable supposition. However, galaxies aren't just stars. They're also surrounded by hydrogen gas. And presumably, antimatter galaxies would be surrounded by antimatter hydrogen. And gas clouds from adjacent galaxies intermingle. Now, when hydrogen and antihydrogen atoms combine, the electron and antimatter electron annihilate one another. When they do that, they emit two gamma rays with a single, unique energy. Astronomers have looked into space and just don't see those kind of gamma rays, so we know that there are no antimatter galaxies. So that's not the answer. Another idea proposed by people first hearing about the problem is maybe our visible universe is made of matter, and the antimatter is relegated to parts of the universe so far away that we can't see them. While we can't disprove that conjecture, it's very difficult to imagine how matter and antimatter could be separated like that. So this is also highly unlikely. So what do we know? Well, we can look at the cosmic microwave background radiation, which contains the residual photons from the Big Bang. By figuring out how many photons of energy are contained in the microwave background to the number of protons in the universe, researchers have determined that something very weird happened in the first moments of the Big Bang. What they've determined is that there was a very, very slight asymmetry in the matter and antimatter of the early universe. For every 3 billion antimatter particles, there were 3 billion and 1 matter particles. The 3 billions canceled, eventually resulting in the cosmic microwave background. The remaining one turned into the stars and galaxies we see, and I hope it's clear that I'm talking about ratios here and not a single particle. So what is the physical phenomena that generated this asymmetry? Well, we don't know. Over the decades, we found a few odd quantum mechanical phenomena that generate some of the asymmetry, but not enough to explain what we observe. Like I said before, it's a mystery, and it's one of the biggest mysteries of modern physics. This is one of the reasons that Fermilab is putting such an effort into building the Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment, or DUNE. One of its goals is to look for differences in the matter and antimatter neutrinos. If we see differences, then maybe a process called leptogenesis is the cause of the asymmetry. Leptogenesis is a super complicated idea, and I made a long-form video about it, which is worth your time. A link is in the description. Now, leptogenesis might not be the right explanation for the matter-antimatter asymmetry, but we won't know until we test it. So that's what we're doing. Okay, so let's take a look at the questions our viewers have posted this week. Talking about the matter-antimatter asymmetry was fun, but questions are funner. So let's get started. Yatsak Pitero notes that the expansion speed of the universe has changed and asks if it will again. Hi, Yatsak. That's a good question. Obviously, since we don't understand everything, the answer to your question could be yes. After all, the laws of physics could spontaneously change tomorrow. It seems unlikely, but I'm in the business of finding the unexpected. But the changing speed of the expansion of the universe wasn't some weird and arbitrary change. It has a clear explanation that should calm any fears of a spontaneous changing of physical laws. It comes down to a couple of things that are woven together. First, gravity by matter, ordinary or dark, is attractive. Second, gravity by dark energy is repulsive. Third, the density of dark energy is constant. And four, the universe is expanding. Those are the four important points. Shortly after the Big Bang, there was a fixed amount of total regular and dark matter in the universe. Dark energy was the same constant density it is now. The visible universe had a smaller volume, so multiplying density by volume gives you the total dark energy, which is, of course, small due to the small volume of the universe. But remember, the universe was expanding. The total amount of matter was constant, but the dark energy was increasing. At about 5 billion years ago, the amount of dark energy equaled the amount of matter. And, of course, over the last 5 billion years, the volume has increased more, leading to more dark energy. Since dark energy is a repulsive form of gravity, it was 5 billion years ago that repulsion overcame attraction and the expansion of the universe sped up. We see that 5 billion years ago wasn't a time when dark energy turned on, so to speak. It just became dominant then. Supel Steve asks how I can say that there are galaxies without dark matter if we don't know that dark matter even exists. Hi, Steve. Yeah, I suppose you're right. I should have said that these galaxies rotate at speeds expected for the known laws of physics and observed ordinary matter. It's more accurate to say that these galaxies don't need any dark matter to explain their behavior. But that's kind of the same thing as saying they don't have dark matter, so... Beppe Minozzi asks if the cosmological constant could be slowly changing. Hi, Beppe. Sure, that idea is called quintessence, and what you suggest is possible. However, we've looked, and the data is consistent with dark energy being a constant density. If it's changing, it's changing very slowly. Improved measurements in the next few years will tell us more. Einstein X admonishes me for having a misleading animation of the Big Bang. Hi, Einstein. Any relationship to the Einstein? Yeah, you're right. I don't like the animation either. It conveys the idea that the Big Bang was like a firecracker, and that's wrong. On the other hand, a more accurate animation would just flash the entire screen to white and then fade to expanding galaxies and such. It's more accurate, but not as visually interesting. Plus, buying animations is expensive. If viewers know of a better one, post the link below and, well, I'll see what I can do. OPN Namdev asks how constant energy density leads to repulsive gravity. Hi, OP. That's simple. It doesn't. It's just that dark energy exerts the opposite type of pressure compared to ordinary matter. If you're interested in a deeper explanation, I posted a link to a blog post by Sean Carroll in the description that goes into it in more detail. Scott Powers asks how I know that dark matter isn't just gas surrounding and within galaxies. Hi, Scott. Luckily, that's an easy one. While gas is invisible to our eyes, it's not invisible in other wavelengths of light, be it infrared, radio, ultraviolet, etc. And we have telescopes that can see all of those wavelengths and more. We know precisely how much gas is out there, and it's 10 times more than the stars we see. Indeed, gas is the dominant form of ordinary matter. Amazingly, if you remove the stars from the universe, it would change the amount of ordinary matter by only 10% or so. But dark matter is 5 times more than the gas we know is out there, so your question is reasonable, but we know that gas isn't the answer. Line Noise asks, if the universe is expanding, why are not galaxies in the Earth and such expanding as well? Hi, Line. Your question is a common and reasonable one. The answer is simple. Dark energy is low density and works only if big volumes are involved. On small volumes, like the solar system, the Milky Way, or even the Virgo cluster of galaxies, ordinary matter is concentrated and the attractive force of ordinary matter is strong enough to overcome dark energy. I put a link in the description for additional reading. Samuel Machado asks if I can extract dark energy and use it for something. Hi, Samuel. Well, I can, but then I have sworn to use my powers only for good. But someone like this guy can. I wouldn't cross him if I were you. Okay, so that's all the time we have for questions today. I'm having a blast doing this. I hope you are too. If you are, please like, subscribe, and share. This series is great fun. It allows me to talk about all sorts of interesting bits of physics from my home. And that's a great way to spend my time because, even at home, physics is everything.